Okay, good morning and welcome to the postgraduate video course on advanced hydrology. We are in chapter 6 these days. In the last class, we looked at certain important functions which are necessary to understand the linear hydrologic system. These three functions which we looked at, I am just going to briefly write them down. First one was the unit impulse response function. All right, we defined it and we looked at how we can get it, and this is nothing but its instantaneous unit hydrograph, which you may have seen in your earlier classes. That was the first one. The second function which we looked at was the unit step response function, and which we said is nothing but your S hydrograph. Okay. And the third function which we saw was unit pulse response function, and which is nothing but your unit hydrograph. All right. And then what we did is we saw the equations or the expressions in terms of each other and the interrelationships of all these three different functions, that is instantaneous unit hydrograph, the S curve and the unit hydrograph. Okay. What we will do today is we will start with the discrete convolution equation. We had seen the integral form of the convolution equation, which is helpful when we have the data at continuous time domain. However, that is not the case for hydrologic variables. Most of the data which we measure or observe, rainfall, whether it is rainfall or runoff, we have them at discrete time steps. So, what we are going to do is we look at the discrete convolution equation first, and then we will come back to the simpler things on unit hydrograph. Discrete convolution equation, which will be very important not only from the point of view of being able to calculate the direct runoff hydrograph response given a complex effective rainfall heatograph and a unit hydrograph. All right. So, if we have the unit hydrograph for a catchment and we know the rainfall, we can find out the direct runoff hydrograph response using this discrete convolution equation, all right, from a complex term. Or this is also useful in the reverse process, that is we can find out the unit hydrograph given the direct runoff hydrograph and the rainfall data in the catchment. All right. So, this process of this convolution equation on the discrete time domain is an important one, and actually we have seen it earlier in the last chapter with reference to the time area diagram. All right. But we are going to revisit it with reference to the effective rainfall and the unit hydrograph. Okay. So, let us first define the variables that are involved in this. PM is the depth of rainfall. Falling during delta t time interval, which is mth actually, that is why that subscript is m, and let us say it is in centimeters or some suitable units. Okay. How can this be defined? Well, this is nothing but the area under the curve between m minus 1 delta t to m delta t of what? Of your intensity curve. Okay. So, you have this I t or I tau, this intensity curve which is available, and then you just integrate it or find the area under that curve. Okay. And this is true for all values of m. M is the index which represents the time interval from 1 to, let us say, all the way to capital M. All right. And what is this? This is what we call is the pulse data representation. This is the pulse data representation. Okay. Let us define q subscript n. Q subscript n as the value of the system output. In the nth time interval, during the nth time interval, which is actually normally at the end of the time interval, if we are using the sample data representation, which is for your flow hydrographs. Okay, we had seen that in an earlier chapter, how these variables are defined in a different manner. U h is equal to your h at time steps of your n delta t, which is the discrete pulse response function, or nothing but your unit hydrograph. All right. So, with these notations, we can write the discrete convolution equation. Then can be described as the following equation, which is, as you may have seen it earlier, what is Q? Q is the direct runoff hydrograph at any time n delta t, all right? N can vary from 1 to capital N, all right? Let me say that here, where your n is 1, 2, all the way to capital N, okay? All right, and this is summation of P m u n minus m plus 1, and I am going to call it as 7.2.15, and this summation runs from m is equal to n such that it is less than or equal to capital M. Okay. We have seen this concept earlier, so it should be easy to understand. Let me rephrase or reiterate the notation on that summation we have seen, n less than equal to m. Means what? It shows that the terms are summed for the values of m varying from 1 to all the way to small n, all right, this number here, okay, for n less than equal to m. And what happens for if the value of n becomes greater than m? Well, the summation is limited to same thing, which is m is equal to 1 to all the way to capital M. Okay. So, capital M is kind of the upper limit up to which you will go in that summation, all right, because that represents what? That is the maximum number of rainfall impulses that are existing, all right, because there is no effective rainfall after that. So, there is not going to be any output due to a rainfall after M. Okay. So, it is basically that is what it means, all right. That is, it is not evaluated, all right, for your values of n greater than m, okay. All right. So, if we want to just look at an example of how we use this summation or this convolution equation, let us say your capital M is equal to 3. What does it mean? It means that you have 3 pulses on your ERH. Okay? Let us say this is P1, P2 and P3. All right? There are only 3 impulses. Of your effective rainfall. Okay? Now, when I apply this equation, this one, with capital M is equal to 3, what will happen? Let us say you do it for n is equal to 1 first, small n can vary from, let me write it here, small n can vary from 1 to all the way to capital N, all right, and capital N can be more than capital M, all right. So, what will be Q1 as per that summation? If you open that summation, you will have how many terms? Only 1. Why? Because n is equal to 1 and we are writing writing the expression for Q1. So, it will be P1 U 1 minus 1 plus 1, like we had done earlier. Okay. N is 1, m is 1 and then you have plus 1. So, this is nothing but your P1 U1, all right. So, m we are taking 1 only for this ordinate. What will be Q2 corresponding to n is equal to 2? Should be easy to see that it will be P1 U2 minus 1 plus 1, okay. P1 U2 minus 1 plus 1, all right. And then there will be second term corresponding to P2, because now n is equal to 2. So, summation is going from 1 to 2, right. So, P2 U of your 2 minus 2 plus 1, which is going to be P1 U2 plus P2 U1, all right. I hope this would be clear. And similarly, you can write other ordinates for N3. It will be Q3 is equal to, I am going to write it directly. So, it will be P1 U3 plus P2 U2 plus P3 U1, all right. And then what do we have here is M is 1, 2 and 3. So, basically you have 3 terms. Okay. Now, what happens when N is 4, or you are trying to find out the DRH ordinate at the end of, let us say, 4th hour? Okay. How many terms are going to be there in the summation? Well, 3 only, because there is only 3 impulses of effective rainfall. Okay. And which 3 terms will be there? Well, you can work it out. It will be P1 U4 plus it will be P2 U3 and P3 U2. All right. Ideally, let me write it here. There should be one more term, which is P4 U1. All right. But your capital M is equal to 3, right. So, there is no P4. So, this term is actually 0. So, we are not writing it. Okay. So, that is what it means, that if you have only capital M number of impulses, anything more than that does not exist. So, that term will drop out. All right. So, let me just let me not delete it and say that higher terms vanish. Okay. And then so on, all right. So, this way we can use this equation, which is your discrete convolution equation, either in a forward direction or in a backward direction, to find the direct runoff response or to find the unit hydrograph through the deconvolution process. Okay. All right. So, the next thing we are going to do is we will move on to some basic stuff, all right, which is on the definition of the unit hydrograph. What are the assumptions or the limitations of a unit hydrograph? How we can determine, how we can calculate a unit hydrograph given the data from a catchment in terms of flow and the area and so on. Okay. All right. So, let us then look at from first principles. The concept of unit hydrograph. Okay. As I said earlier, it was proposed by Sherman in 1932, all right. And this concept of unit hydrograph is still used in the same form or the original form. Okay. It is so practically useful, all right. How do we define a unit hydrograph? Let me just write the definition first and then we will revisit it. A unit hydrograph is a direct runoff hydrograph, all right, resulting from one inch or 1 centimeter or unit basically of effective rainfall generated, how it is important, uniformly over the drainage area. What does it mean that the unit hydrograph is generated uniformly over the drainage area? Means the amount of rainfall is uniform over the space, the whole drainage basin or the whole catchment. Okay? So, there is a variation with respect to space is not there, all right? It is assuming, so it is a lumped model. Okay? So, the uniformly over the drainage area at a constant rate, all right? So, you see that there is another assumption inherent in the definition of the unit hydrograph. At a constant rate means the distribution of the rainfall with respect to time also is uniform, okay, for a specified duration. For a specified duration, okay, each and every term is very important. Let us say D, right. So, a unit hydrograph is defined for a particular duration D, okay, and the value of D can be 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hours, 6 hours, 12 hours, whatever. Right. So, whenever we say a unit hydrograph, we always put a D hour unit hydrograph in front of it. Right. What does that mean? That means it is a unit hydrograph of 12 hour duration or D hour duration. What does that duration represent? That is nothing but the duration of the effective rainfall. Okay. All right. So, rain is falling uniformly over the drainage area at a constant rate, at a constant, I think I need the term rate here, a constant rate for a specified duration, all right, and this duration is, let me say, effective for the effective rainfall, okay, not the total duration, right. Now, a unit hydrograph is a simple linear model. All right, which can be used or that can be used to do what? To calculate DRH from any amount of rainfall . Okay, how? Through the use of your discrete convolution equation, which we have just seen, discrete convolution equation. Okay, or I should say rather, and it can also be used how to calculate or determine UH given the DRH, all right, given the DRH and the effective rainfall data, how? Through a deconvolution process. That is using the discrete convolution equation in the reverse direction. That process is called the deconvolution. We will come to that little later in this course today. Okay? So, this is the definition of a unit hydrograph, and as I said, it is very important to understand. It is the direct runoff hydrograph response from a catchment when the catchment is subjected to 1 centimeter of effective rainfall. And how is that rainfall? That rainfall is uniformly distributed over space and time, both space and time, all right. And another condition is that this unit hydrograph is defined for a specified duration, all right, D hour. And that D is what? That is the duration or the time during which the effective rainfall is occurring. Okay? So, this is the complete definition of your unit hydrograph. The next thing we are going to look at is some of the assumptions or some of the limitations of this theory. Okay? Many of these you may have seen earlier, but we will just reiterate, list all of them so that we understand when we can use this and when we cannot use this. Okay? All right, so, let me list the assumptions or some of them may be the limitations. Of your UH theory. Okay. All right. So, the first one is the effective rainfall has constant intensity during the effective duration. Okay. This assumption is actually inherent in the definition of the unit hydrograph itself. We said that the rate at which rain is falling is constant, all right. That means the it is a constant intensity during that duration, all right. Why it is important is because we are assuming that rain is uniform, all right. And so that when we are looking at the data set we have or the historical records, we should find out such data for which in a particular duration the rainfall is more or less uniform. So, we need to be able to meet or satisfy these assumptions or limitations as far as possible when we are developing a unit hydrograph. Okay. So, that was the first one, and you will see that some of these are already inherent in the definition. The effective rainfall is uniformly distributed throughout the whole drainage area. Okay. This was also part of the definition, all right. I will not spend much time on that. It basically means that your rainfall is constant with respect to space. The third one is the base time of the direct runoff hydrograph from any amount of effective rainfall of duration D is constant. Is constant and what? Proportional to the total amount of direct runoff produced by each hydrograph. Okay. So, what is this assumption telling us? It is basically telling us that the base time of various direct runoff hydrographs. Okay. What is the base time? If you have the unit hydrograph or the direct runoff hydrograph, the time at which the runoff response starts, direct runoff response starts, and the time at which the DRH response ends, that the time elapsed between those two points, okay, that is called the time base, all right. So, the time base of all the direct runoff hydrographs, all right, which are produced by effective rainfalls of any amount, all right, but occurring in a D hour duration, all right. Let us say you are looking at 2 hour duration effective rainfall, all right. So, in that 2 hours, if you have a rainfall event of 1 centimeter, 5 centimeters, 10 centimeters, all right, but occurring in 2 hours, D hours, that is constant, all right. The response from the catchment, all right, will have the same time base or the base time, okay, from all of those different storm events having different magnitudes of effective rainfall. So, that is all it is saying, okay. Moving on, the next assumption states that the ordinates of all direct runoff hydrographs of a common time base of a common time base are directly proportional to the total amount of direct runoff. It is basically very similar to what we have just said above, all right. The base time is same for all the DRHs having the same duration for the effective rainfall. And also now what we are saying is that the ordinates of different DRHs will be in the proportion of the total amount of DRH, all right. Again, it is the another way of saying the proportionality, okay. The next one, you will see that many of these may be interrelated to each other. For a given catchment, or for a given watershed, the hydrograph resulting from a given effective rainfall reflects what? Reflects the unchanging characteristics of the catchment. Okay. So, let us look at this statement again and then I will try to explain it. For a given catchment, the hydrograph resulting from a given effective rainfall reflects what? The unchanging characteristics of the catchment. What do we mean by that? Let us say you have the data, all right, you have collected the data in terms of rainfall, runoff, etcetera, and then you have developed a unit hydrograph. Okay. So, once you have the unit hydrograph and then you are applying it in future for several years, right, then this unit hydrograph which we have developed is not able to account for the changes that are taking place in your catchment. Those changes can be in terms of the development in the catchment. For example, the new buildings may be coming up, the paved areas may be coming up, that will actually affect the shape of your direct runoff response and hence the unit hydrograph, all right. So, if you have a very fastly changing characteristics in a catchment, then the unit hydrograph has to be updated at regular intervals, all right. So, basically what we are saying is that it assumes once you have developed that the characteristics of the catchment are same, okay. The next one is the DRH response to effective rainfall is time invariant. And linear. This is a very famous assumption. I am sure you may have seen it earlier in your undergraduate hydrology course, right. So, this is it is again a reiteration, it is a linear system. So, we are saying that we can use the proportionality and superposition, all right. So, the unit hydrograph theory is linear, number one. And the number two, we are saying that it is time invariant. What do we mean by the DRH response from a catchment is time invariant? It means that once you have developed a unit hydrograph, you apply it to a rainfall event, whether it occurs in January or April or October or December, it does not matter. It is going to give you the same direct runoff response. Okay? So, it represents a invariant response, or the response from the UH will not depend upon when the rainfall has occurred. Okay? Moving on. The next assumption, number 7, we say that the unit hydrograph theory is applicable to rainfall only. What do we mean by that? Obviously, we have seen that there are many forms of precipitation. So, it is not applicable to snow, ice or any other form of precipitation, all right. So, we are saying that the unit hydrograph theory is applicable only to the liquid precipitation form, which is the rainfall, ok. The next one, the catchment area, the drainage area or the watershed area upper limit of that is approximately 5000 square kilometers, ok. And the lower limit is approximately 200 hectares, ok. The unit hydrograph theory we apply, all right, for moderate sized catchments, all right, not too small and not too large also, ok. Upper limit we are saying is 5000 square kilometers, all right. And why is this limit? Because the basic assumptions which we are making with respect to the uniform intensity and the uniform rainfall with respect to space, etcetera, they would no longer be valid if your size of the catchment is too big, all right. So, due to those reasons we are saying that this unit hydrograph theory is applicable to an upper limit of 5000 square kilometers and the lower limit of 200 hectares, ok. The next one is the catchment should not have the large storage structures, any large storage structures like what? For example, reservoirs, ponds, lakes, etcetera, maybe tanks, etcetera. Why? Okay. The assumption we are saying is what? That the catchment should not have large storage structures, all right. We are talking about the rainfall runoff modeling here, ok. We have the effective rainfall and we are using the unit hydrograph theory to convert that into the direct runoff, all right. So, while we are talking about this rainfall runoff process, it is basically what? In one of the earlier lectures we had seen that while the rainfall is getting converted into runoff, what happens is the rainfall goes into various storages in the catchment, all right, the natural storages in the catchment, all right. But if we have additional artificial storages, that will alter the storage characteristics of the catchment, all right, due to which the runoff response will become more complicated, all right. More the complications, more will be the violations as far as the assumptions and limitations are concerned, all right. So, this theory is actually not applicable, or it will not give good results, I should say, when you have large ponds or dams and reservoirs in the catchment, all right. So, it is mainly for the virgin flows, ok. And why is that? Because the effects, as I said, of artificial storages, which I have just mentioned here, will affect the linear relationship. Okay, which is we had seen S is equal to KQ. Okay. As you know, the unit hydrograph is based on the linear assumption theory, in which we have storage as a function of k times q, all right. But if we have some additional storages in the catchment, that will affect this linear relationship and it may become nonlinear, all right, or it may add to the nonlinearity of the storage behavior of a catchment, okay, in which the this theory is not actually not valid, okay. Moving on to the derivation of the unit hydrograph given the data. We just looked at the definition of the unit hydrograph and also the basic assumptions or the limitations, all right. So, now we will move on to the derivation of the unit hydrograph, okay, given the flow data and the catchment area. All right, and also you will need rainfall, okay, for the complex storm case. All right, so what we will do is we will look at the procedure of derivation or calculation of the unit hydrograph for two cases. All right, case one will be when the data are from a simple storm or a single storm or an isolated rainfall impulse, all right, which is producing certain runoff. And then later on we will look at, well, these kind of data are very difficult to find, all right, an isolated storm in which there is no rainfall on either side and then it is nicely isolated, all right. But we may have you know, the data, very useful data when you have a complex storm, that is you have back to back you know, rainfall impulses of certain duration, all right. So, we should be able to find out the unit hydrograph from a complex storm also, okay. So, let us look at the case one first, which is simple storm or single isolated storm. What is a storm? The rainfall event we are talking of duration D, all right. So, you have the data corresponding to a isolated storm which occurs for duration D, the effective duration D, okay. And then you have the flow hydrograph measured at the outlet of the catchment at a river or a stream at some location, okay. How do we find the unit hydrograph ordinates using this data, okay. So, what I will do is I will give you a step by step procedure first and then we will look at one example of case one, okay. So, let us look at the procedure first. In the first step, what do you do? Well, you select, you scan through all the data you have and select an isolated storm having desired duration D, okay, of what? Well, the assumptions are important. So, we say a fairly uniform intensity, that is with respect to time, and which is uniformly distributed with respect to space. Okay. How do we determine these two things? Well, we look at, let us say your value of D is 3 hours. So, what you do is you scan through all the data in the past 50 years, 100 years of data, pick up all those storms which have a duration of 3 hours, okay. And then you see during those 3 hours in different you know, storms, how the rainfall was distributed with respect to time. All right, in the first hour how much was the rainfall, second hour how much was the rainfall, third hour how much was the rainfall, and then you pick up the one which has uniform or the more or less same amount of rainfall in the 3 hours or continuously. So, you have same intensity or the constant intensity with respect to time. Also, you want to make sure that the rainfall is uniformly distributed with respect to space, all right. So, how do we make that sure? Well, we may have 2-3 different rain gauges in the catchment. All right. So, we select a particular date and time, let us say for these 3 hours on you know, January 29th 1970, that is the storm you have selected. So, on that date, that time you see the values of rainfall in different rain gauges in the catchment, okay. And you find out that the variation from one location to the other is not significant, all right. So, you pick up a data or a storm which is isolated and for which your rainfall intensity is uniform with respect to time and it is also uniform with respect to space. So, you see that meeting those assumptions is not easy. So, selection of the data is a very important step. So, as far as this exercise is concerned, we'll assume that we have this data, all right? What's the next step? Number 2, what we do is we plot the flow hydrograph or hydrograph for the selected storm or resulting from that storm, all right. What's a hydrograph? Well, basically it is a curve between Q and T, time versus the total flow, all right. Next step is what? Separate the base flow. Separate the base flow, okay, and develop your DRH, all right. So, graphically, if I want to explain it to you, this is your flow hydrograph, or this is your hydrograph which is observed or measured, all right. This is T versus Q, all right. And then you want to separate the base flow so that you have the DRH. And we have seen 3 different methods of base flow separation in the previous chapter. So, we can use any one of them and we can code them in a computer program also. So, let us say that you are using the straight line method, all right. So, this is your DRH, everything above is DRH and everything below is your base flow or QG, all right. So, you subtract the base flow from your total flows, all right. So, that gives you the direct run of hydrograph, all right. So, we develop the DRH, that is step number 3. What is the next step? Number 4, we find the volume of your DRH, all right. How do you find the volume of this direct runoff hydrograph? It is nothing but the area under that curve, all right. So, you have the Q, let us say in meter cube per second, time is in hours, all right. So, you just integrate that curve, or you can divide it into strips, all right, get those areas and add all of those up, all right. So, this is nothing but equivalent to your area under the DRH, okay. And if I want to look at here, it will be what? I am going to hatch it like this, it is this area under this curve. Okay, you have the volume of the direct runoff hydrograph, okay. Now, you want to find out what is the next step? You want to find out the effective rainfall due to which this DRH was produced, all right. So, what will be the depth of ER or effective rainfall which produced this DRH? Well, it will be nothing but the volume of DRH which you have just found in the previous step divided by what? The area of the catchment. Okay. And you can convert these into suitable units, you know, so that you have the answer in centimeters. Okay. All right. So, now you have a DRH, all right. So, you had the total flow hydrograph, you have subtracted the base flow, you have the DRH. You also have the amount of effective rainfall that produced this DRH, all right. So, how can you find a unit hydrograph of D hour duration? It is a very simple problem. We can use the principle of proportionality, which we have been talking about a lot in this chapter, all right. So, you have a DRH from, let us say, x centimeter of rainfall, okay. So, how do you find the unit hydrograph? You just divide the DRH ordinates by x, that will give you the ordinates of the unit hydrograph, okay. So, the last step then is number 6, divide the ordinates of DRH by the depth of ER which you just found, all right, so that your D hour UH will be nothing but your DRH ordinates divided by depth of ER. Okay. So, you see that this is a very simple procedure, you know, in a step by step procedure I have given you how we can calculate or find out the unit hydrograph from an isolated simple single storm. Okay. What I am going to do is quickly look at an example on how we actually apply this method. Okay. So, let us look at the example on calculation of UH given your flow data and the area of the catchment. Okay. So, let us say that the area of the catchment is 200 square kilometers and you are given that the flow hydrograph ordinates from or resulting from a 4-hour ER. Given as follows, let us say this is your time in hours and this will run from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9 and the flow which is given is in let us say meter cube per second. Okay. This is measured hydrograph. Okay. This data we have which is given to us. I am just throwing some numbers here. Okay. All right. So, what you have is the flow hydrograph given to us and these are the time in hours. All right. So, this is the flood hydrograph which is measured at the outlet of some basin which has an area of 200 square kilometers. Okay. What is the first step which we had looked at? If you go back, the first step is, well, it is the select the isolated storm. Let us say we have selected that and we have the data. Plot this. All right. We can plot that and the first step then is the separate the base flow and develop the DRH. All right. So, in this case what we are going to do is we will not plot it, but we will see that or we will find out what is the base flow. You see that the first ordinate, all right, at time 0 or when the rainfall has not begun, all right, is 30, all right, at the end also it is 30. So, you can assume the base flow let us say is 30 meter cube per second, okay, rather than plotting and then dividing a line. We can do that, but for the demonstration purposes we will take the value of the base flow as 30 meter cube per second. Okay. So, with that maybe you can have a column which says QG meter cube per second. All right. So, it will be 30, 30 at each time step here all the way it is 30. Okay. Now, the next step is you find the DRH. Okay. How do you find the DRH? You subtract the base flow from the measured total flow. All right. That will give you the ordinates of the direct runoff hydrograph. Okay. So, you have 30 minus 30 is 0 and then 80 minus 30 is 50 and so on. So, you keep on subtracting 30 from this. So, you have 70, 170, 220, 170, 150, 70, 50 and then last one is 0. Okay. So, this is the direct runoff hydrograph in meter cube per second. What is the next step? Once you have found the direct runoff hydrograph, all right, find the number 4 is find the volume of the DRH, which is what? The area under the curve. Okay. How do you find that? Area under this, well, we can divide this into strips, all right. And let us say we already have these strips of 1 hour each, Alright, on the time domain you have 1 hour, you have the ordinate. Okay. So, what you can do is, the best way to do is just sum these DRH ordinates and multiplied by the time or delta t, which is 1 hour. Alright. So, you just do that summation, assuming that strip to be rectangular. So, there are certain assumptions, it will not be very exact, but still we can use that. So, if you sum it up, it will be 950 watt meter cube per second. All right. The next step is you find out effective rainfall. Effective rainfall, as we said, is what? It is the volume of the direct runoff hydrograph divided by the catchment area, right. What is the volume? Well, it is 950 meter cube per second multiplied by what? Delta t for 1 hour. The strip is of 1 hour duration, okay, each of them. So, it will be, let us say 60 times 60, which is 3600 actually, that many seconds in an hour. All right. So, that what you have in the numerator is the volume in meter cube. This divided by the area of the catchment, which is given to us as 200 square kilometers. So, you have 10 to the power 6. All right. So, this answer will be what? This answer will be in meters. Okay. So, you multiply this whole thing by 100. So, you will have it in centimeters. Okay. So, this is your effective rainfall or the depth of the direct runoff hydrograph, which will come out to be 1.71 centimeters. Okay. So, all we have done is we have added the DRH ordinates, okay, multiplied that by the amount of or the number of seconds in 1 hour and divided by the area, taken care of the units and find or calculate the effective rainfall as 1.71 centimeters. Okay. The next step is what? If you go back, the last step is you divide the ordinates, this step we are talking, divide the ordinates of the DRH by the depth of effective rainfall, and the depth of effective rainfall in our case is what? 1.71. What is the DRH? This one, this column. So, you divide this column by 1.71, that will give you what? The ordinates of 4 hour UH in meter cube per second. Okay. So, if you do that, you are going to have 0, 29, 41, you can verify these numbers, 99 129 99 88 41 29 and 0. Okay. So, this is your then final answer. What is this? This is your 4 hour unit hydrograph from the 4 hour storm data given. Okay. So, that way we see that we have looked at the procedure of finding out the unit hydrograph when you have a single storm. All right. That was our case 1. Okay. Now, what we will do is, we will look at the case 2, in which there is no single storm, but there is effective rainfall impulse back to back. There may be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different impulses. Okay. What do we do in that case? Okay. Because the DRH response is complex. It is not coming from single storm, but it is coming from many effective rainfall impulses. Okay. So, you have the case 2. Complex storm of duration 2 okay. Multiple of d means what? For example, I will just take a very small example. You have this rainfall occurring in d hours, this is d, let us say this is p1, then you have right next to it, you have same duration d, another rainfall event of p2 magnitude, then the third one you have the same duration. So, the total duration is this, all right, but these are multiples of d, all right, and we are trying to find out the d hour unit hydrograph. So, we have this rainfall data P1, P2, P3, all right, or the complex storm data. We also have the DRH from this ER. Okay. So, the data which we have is, let us say, PM is the axis rainfall depth, and M is varying from, let us say, 1, 2, 3 all the way to capital M. So, we are going to be general. The example I have shown here is only 3 impulses, but let us say you have capital M number of effective rainfalls. Capital M can be 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, any number. All right. Let us say we have the data of QN. QN is what? The DRH ordinates. The DRH ordinates, all right, such that your N is 1, 2, 3 all the way to, let us say, capital N. Now, the data I am saying here is directly your direct runoff hydrograph. So, if you have the flood hydrograph data, the total flow data, you carry out the base flow separation part. Okay? So, I am not considering that in this particular case, the case 2. Okay? So, let us say we have done that, and the Q's here represent the direct runoff hydrograph response. All right? So, this is the direct runoff. All right. Let us say that U is the UH ordinate to be found. Okay? How can we solve this problem? Okay? Any ideas? You think about it, today we looked at what is called a discrete convolution equation, in which we said it can be used in a forward direction or for the process of convolution, in which if we have the rainfall data given, we can find out the DRH response. All right? We can also use that in a reverse direction, which is called the deconvolution process, in which if the flow data is given or the DRH data is given, effective rainfall data is given, we can deconvolute this data and find out the unit hydrograph. All right? So, we will use the discrete convolution equation here. How? For the deconvolution process. That is, we are using it in the reverse direction. All right. So, let me first write this equation. So, what we will do is, we will write all the data or all the equations, right, using this discrete convolution equation. And then, we will look at two different methods, how we can use this discrete convolution equation in the reverse direction. Okay. So, let me first write it. So, you have Qn as we just looked at today, I am going from 1 to n less than equal to m of your Pm u n minus m plus 1, and let me number this as 7, 4, 1. Okay. The number of ordinates of your unit hydrograph are going to be capital N minus m plus 1. Okay? So, we will take it from the theory of this linear systems, in which if you have capital N is the number of DRH ordinates, capital M is the number of effective rainfall impulses, then the number of UH ordinates is going to be N minus m plus 1. All right? Okay, so, what we will do is, we will expand the equation 7, 4, 1, all right, and then use the deconvolution process. Okay? So, I think it is going to take some time. So, I am running out of time today. So, what we will do is, we will expand this equation 7.4.1, write how many equations? Capital N number of equations. You see that the discrete convolution equation, this q small n, all right, small n is varying from 1, 2, 3 up to capital N. So, how many equations you will have? You will have capital N number of equations, all right. So, we will write these n equations and then we will find out, or we will look at two methods of finding out the unit hydrograph. So, I would like to stop at this point of time and we will start tomorrow. Thank you.